sir, the Republicans are trying to blame you for the existence of a small air base at Mena, Arkansas. This base was set up by George Bush and Oliver North and the CIA to help the Iran-Contras, and they brought in plane load after plane load of cocaine there for sale in the United States. And then they took the money and bought weapons and took them back to the Contras, all of which was illegal, as you know, under the Boland Act. But tell me, did they tell you that this had to be in existence because of national security?
Well, let me answer the question. No, they didn't tell me anything about it. They didn't say anything to me about it. The airport in question and all the events in question were the subject of state and federal inquiries. It was primarily a matter for federal jurisdiction. The state really had next to nothing to do with it. The local prosecutor did conduct an investigation based on what was within the jurisdiction of state law. The rest of it was under jurisdiction of the United States attorneys who were appointed successively by previous administrations. We had nothing, zero, to do with it, and everybody who's ever looked into it knows that.
Polk County Prosecutor Charles Blake, the man who initially attempted to investigate the Mena, Arkansas criminal activities, would surely take exception to Mr. Clinton's assertion that, quote, the local prosecutor did conduct an investigation based on what was within the jurisdiction of the state law, end quote. In fact, it was Blake who went directly to then-Governor Clinton to seek funding for his investigation, seeing as how rural Polk County lacked the financial resources to deal with the CIA.
When it became apparent that nothing was going to be done on the federal level, that's when I began more actively pursuing it.
Prosecutor Black, a Clinton supporter, met with the governor and handed him a letter requesting money for a state grand jury on Mena.
His response to me was that he would get a man, something to the effect that he would get a man on it and would get word back to me. And I never heard back.
Years later, Clinton said he offered $25,000 to Prosecutor Black's boss to fund a grand jury. But Charles Black and his boss claimed they never heard about any offer of money from Governor Clinton.
I believe Bill Clinton's an honest, respectable man, and I have to believe that he did that. But the fact is, I never got that word myself.
Black. Another thing about how perspectives change over time. Bobby Rush, member of Congress, said the other day, I'm ashamed that I voted for the 94 crime bill. You ashamed of that bill?
Not at all. And in fact, I drafted the bill, as you remember.
I know that.
And by the way, we talk about this mostly in terms of Black Lives Matter. Black lives really do matter. But the problem is institutional racism in America. That's the overarching problem that still exists. And we should be talking about it. And you look at it, the legacy of racism in housing and jobs and so on. So, but having said that, if you take a look at the crime bill, of the money in the crime bill, the vast majority went to reducing sentences, diverting people from going to jail for drug offenses into what I came up with, the drug courts, providing for boot camps instead of sending people to prisons.
So 25 years after the 1994 crime bill was enacted, we are still having conversations about the import and significance of the bill.
That 1994 crime bill, it did contribute to mass incarceration in our country.
It's important that people remember the context of the political environment in the early 1990s.
The other big piece of legislation on Capitol Hill tonight is the crime bill.
Now, violent crime peaked in 1991, and the drafters of the bill didn't know that in 1993 and 1994 when they were drafting and signing it. Urban areas, urban cities across the country were ravaged by crack cocaine, and Americans were afraid of crime. The 1994 crime bill was signed by President Bill Clinton. You know, this was a pretty significant bill at the time, and President Clinton and Senator Biden at the time were right that the bill was significant.
The most significant federal effort to deal with violent crime in America that has ever been undertaken.
It was important for a Democrat at the time to be seen as taking a significant role in trying to reduce crime and violence in the United States. And at the time, the Congressional Black Caucus was part of the debate around the crime bill. And The Congressional Black Caucus didn't want every provision that was included in this bill. It became clear that the provisions in the 94 crime bill were going to be a political compromise. And so the history is much more complicated than is sometimes portrayed by the media. Now, what did the bill do? Just like a lot of political compromises, there was the good and there was the bad. For example, the bill eliminated 19 types of semi-automatic assault weapons. It also provided huge amounts of funding to hire cops. 100,000 cops were funded. It was about $14 million at the time for community policing. The bill also enacted the Violence Against Women Act that provided funding to protect women and victims of domestic violence and crimes against women. But the most pernicious provision of the 1994 crime bill was its $12 billion that was authorized for states across the country that would enact what's called truth in sentencing laws. That funding literally paid states to increase the number of prison beds that they allocated for individuals convicted of violent crime in this country to serve 85% of their sentences behind bars. The reason that provision is so important and the reason we're still talking about it today is the federal government essentially subsidized states across the country to build more prisons. So 25 years later, you know, the crime bill is being debated.
You stood up and used that tough on crime phony rhetoric.
That bill was a huge mistake.
There's no question that that crime bill contributed to America's mass incarceration problem.
1994 crime bill, we had a gigantic epidemic in America of violence, particularly in African-American communities. The notion was overwhelmingly supported. It was supported by the Black Caucus in the United States Senate, by and large.
And the reason that the crime bill comes up so often is, you know, today in 2019, it is hard for so many people to understand why the federal government would pay states to incarcerate more people, given the devastating consequences we know that incarceration causes. But at the time, policymakers felt the need to respond to what they felt was uncontrolled violence. And this bill was the way that policymakers, that Congress could say, we're do something about it.
Violent crime and the fear it provokes are crippling our society. The crime bill before Congress gives you a chance to do something about it, a chance to be tough and smart.
We need to examine the crime bill and all of the federal bills that galvanized prison spending, that galvanized more arrests, more incarceration, and we need to look to the future. And today, the United States leads the world in terms of incarceration. In fact, if each state were its own country, 23 states would have the highest incarceration rate in the world. Any candidate running for election who's serious about criminal justice reform, who's serious about cutting the prison population by 50%, needs to take a hard look at what has worked and hasn't worked in terms of our past criminal justice policies and understand that federal funding to increase the number of beds in prisons across the country is simply not a way to create safer and healthier.
Early on when I was a kid, I'd say, when I was a young senator, I'd say, if I were a Jew, I'd be a Zionist. I am a Zionist. You don't have to be a Jew to be a Zionist.
Welcome to the Crypto Teacher. And guys, you know, I come back with that second video just to make you think. And we have Joe Biden. Who is Joe Biden? We know he's been in office for, what, about 36 years? So we know that he's a master at the Hegelian dialectic. Conflict management. Never solving anything. Let's go back to the 1994 crime bill. Now, we know Clinton, before he became president, he was what? The governor of Arkansas, where they was flying all those good drugs, that good cocaine and everything in there, with Oliver North, the CIA. And that's how he became president. Same way with Kamala Harris. She didn't go after Steve Mnuchin, and he becomes the Secretary of the Treasury. So we have Biden drafts this bill. Now, do we believe that Biden drafted this bill? No, we do not. We know that he's a part of the New World Order from the very beginning. This bill destroyed families, especially the black family. But guys, this was strategic. They were able to build more prisons instead of schools. So they were getting paid billions and billions and billions of dollars, not only for all those people in the beds, but then also taking these companies public. So remember that the NWO always has a plan. When they were moving all those drugs inside the United States, they knew that they were going to put them out on the streets to create the crime and then run in with the solution. So what did they do, guys? They created the problem, waited for the reaction. The people were begging, hey, get these people off the street. They're doing these drugs. They're shooting. And what did they do? They ran in with the solution. And that was a 1994 crime bill. So guys, when you see Joe Biden, know he's nothing but a criminal that should be in prison. Have a wonderful day.